Okay, well, good evening, everybody. It's a joy to be with you all here this evening. Our God is the God who meets with us in his beautiful grace, the God who gives rest to the weary, comfort to those who mourn, strength to the weak, love to the unloved, and grace to sinners in Christ, meets with us, his people, here at church. So it's a joy to be with you all here this evening. If I could ask that you open your Bibles to our call to worship for this evening, which is Psalm 133 is our call to worship for this evening. Psalm 133, a song of ascents of David, reading from verse 1. Behold how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Let's respond now to the reading of God's word with a song that I sing together. Our first song for this evening, Psalm 27. This is the new one, so you're going to play it through and then... Okay, so we'll play it through and then I'll signal and you should all stand and we'll go from there.
Thank you.
pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beautiful words of the psalm as you declare the goodness and pleasant nature of brothers dwelling in unity. Father, we pray that we would be a church that would dwell in unity. We pray that we would be a church that would be united in heart and mind, that we would have as the one thing that we seek together, the thing that the psalmist in Psalm 27 seeks, that he would dwell in your house and gaze upon your beauty. And we pray that that would be our heart even this evening, that we would be united in that one desire as a church to dwell here, to stay here, and to gaze upon your beauty as we see your beauty in your word. Father, we thank you for the beauty of your word. We thank you that your word is beautiful. We thank you that it is the most beautiful thing in all the universe, the revelation that you have given of yourself. And we pray that it would be beautiful to us even this evening, that our greatest delight would be found in your word as you reveal yourself to us through it by your Spirit. When we prayed these things, that we might be grown in our love for you, that we might love you more, we pray that we would gaze upon your beauty, and in gazing upon your beauty, have our hearts grown in their love for you and in their love for one another and in our unity together as a church, that we might be of one mind, that we might seek your will above all else, that we might glorify you as a united people. We pray for these things for your glory. We pray for these things for the good of our neighbors, as the church is unified and as the world sees that, and the witness that that bears to you, to the truth of your word and to the gospel. But we do come needy as well. We do come so desperately weak, and we thank you that you come so full of grace to strengthen us where we are weak, and to refresh us where we are weary, and to renew us where we need renewal. And we pray that you would do all of these things this evening, that you would forgive us of our sin, that you would cleanse us of our sin, that you would cleanse us of any sort of division, that we might be united in heart and mind, in Christ and love. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. So before we turn to the text for this evening, we will sing one more song, and that song is Beautiful Saviour. So if you can stand, we'll sing that together.
Thank you.
Wonderful. So we have the privilege again of hearing from Josh as he brings the word this evening. So Josh, I'll ask you to come forward and you can take it from there. Thanks.
Good evening, everyone. Once again, it is a joy to be with you. If you would turn in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 4, we'll be reading today from Philippians 4, verses 1 through 9. And lest you think that I have forgotten a significant portion of my sermon or that I'm leaving a part of the text out, we'll read Philippians 4, 1 through 9, but focus today on verses 1 through 3. So Philippians 4, reading from verse 1. Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. I entreat Euodia and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. God's word is a lamp, our path, and a light for our feet. Will you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we thank you that your word does indeed illumine the path before us. That were it not for your word, we would be like those in darkness, hands groping around for the way in which we should walk. And yet we thank you that your word and your spirit attending to your word show us the path that we are to walk, illumine the path before us, and guide us in all things. Lord, we pray that today as we study your word once again, that you would illumine our minds, that you would open our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our hearts to understand, that you would produce great affection for you and for your word and for your people as a result, Lord. We come to you a needy and depending people and ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Not too long ago, there was a survey taken of Christians in the United Kingdom. And in that survey, people were asked, what is the main reason that people leave church? What is the main reason that people leave church? I wonder if your answer would be the same as theirs. Contrary to what we might think, it wasn't for doctrinal reasons. It wasn't because they had stopped believing in the gospel. But 74% of people said they left church because of disagreements they had with other Christians. 74%. Similarly, a different kind of survey was given, and this helps us understand what kind of disagreements these might have been. In this survey, of the disagreements that people had, these were rarely doctrinal, but centered around power, control, and personal preferences. Some 85% of people, of that bigger 74%, said that the disagreements which lead to people leaving are these kind of interpersonal disagreements. And we can think to ourselves that this surely seems like a modern problem. And surely it's people in their self-centered ways who are very much modern and independent and free-thinking people who are interacting with one another in this way. And maybe we say to ourselves, if only, as we do so often, if only we could return to the book of Acts, to the New Testament, to the church in its purest form, surely we would have no disagreements then. Or if we perhaps did have a disagreement, maybe only it would be about the gospel, the really important things. And yet we read in Philippians 4 about Euodia and Syntyche. We read in Philippians 4 that this same issue of interpersonal disagreements goes back to the very infancy of the church. This might seem like bad news at first. It might seem like bad news because we think to ourselves, then surely not much is going to change moving forward. That we are going to be battling with this forever and always until the Lord returns. But there is good news too. You see, the good news is that if the Philippian church was struggling with this same thing, and if Paul was writing to them, then Paul's words to the Philippian church have a very real and present and relevant word for us today. For those of us who are tempted towards disagreement, for those of us who are perhaps in the midst of disagreement, for those of us who are trying to help people in disagreement, there is a gospel answer to that very problem. This letter, the letter to the Philippian church, really can be summarized as a letter about gospel fellowship or gospel partnership. And this magnificent theme, which has gone from the beginning to the end, now centers around one very specific issue, the issue concerning Euodia and Syntyche. And it's as if all that Paul has written so far now comes to focus. It now comes to a head, and this becomes the one specific issue he'll reference as his reason for writing. All the general encouragements which have happened previously, all the times that Paul has encouraged them to stand together, to be of one mind in chapter 2, to look out together in chapter 3, to have this concept of being already in Christ but not yet perfect, all of these things now come to bear in chapter 4 when he writes, "Therefore, I urge you, I entreat you to agree in the Lord." You see, the Philippian church were facing challenges from the outside in forms of Roman persecution, as well as in the form of doctrinal false teaching. Those dogs and mutilators and evildoers in chapter 3 were beginning to have an influence. And now all of the persecution and pressure from the outside has maybe caused a fissure that was already there to deepen and crack and grow further apart. That these two women who perhaps had once been very close in their relationship now were needing an apostolic reminder and encouragement to agree together. Now when we read this, I think our gut reaction is often to think to ourselves, "I sure am glad that my name isn't recorded alongside a friend for 2,000 years of church history as being encouraged to agree in the Lord." But there is a real blessing in what Paul is doing here. And there is a real sense in which it's very different from the other ways that we see him address error or people in error. You see, what we often see is when Paul is addressing error in the church, he's very specific on the issue at hand, and very general about the people who are the problem. Think about the Galatian heresy. Crystal clear, razor sharp on the issues at hand, and he doesn't mention a single name. Here, very general about what the problem is, but he mentions these two women by name. I think what that shows is that this is an in-house problem. It's not dealing with the Galatian false teachers who are outside the church and needing to be protected from them, but he is talking to two dear sisters, and he's encouraging them, agree in the Lord. He names them, and that's a very important thing that we'll come to see later. And so these challenges that were really assaulting the Philippian church from all sides, from the outside, the secular world, from the outside, false teaching realm, and now in the inside, relationally, are really starting to develop and grow deeper. And so Paul writes to them and he says this, and this is the thrust of this whole section, chapter 4, 1 through to 9, is he says, "Because you are united in Christ, stand firm." Because you are united in Christ, stand firm. Or to put it as Paul puts it, he says, "Stand firm in the Lord." Stand firm in the Lord. But he begins verse 1 with that magical word that we often see in Scripture, which ties things together. He says, "Therefore." And when he says, "therefore," that word really is a bridge from chapter 3 on to chapter 4. And so when we see the word "therefore," we ought to look back and think to ourselves, what does he have in mind when he's writing? And again, specifically, because he's saying that we are to stand firm in the Lord, we should ask ourselves, do we see any of that theme appear previously? And we don't have to look very far, but to see in chapter 3, verse 12, and chapter 3, verse 20, that Paul has written that Jesus Christ has made him his own. And then in verse 20, that we await from heaven a Savior, Jesus Christ, who will transform us. This is the standing firm. It's standing firm in your new identity. It's standing firm in the fact that Christ Jesus has made you his own. That he has said, you are mine and I am yours. Paul's calling the Philippian church to remember their union with him. And so it's standing rooted and grounded. It's as if the sphere in which you're standing, or it's as if the circle on the ground in which you stand, that is what it means to be in Christ. He's saying, stay there. Don't step out anywhere else. Remain where it is safe. Rest and trust and rely on Christ and all that he is. Stand firm. Stay put. You don't have to run. You don't have to go looking. You don't have to go working for that kind of identity. You can stand firm in Christ. But there's also a sense in which he's saying, stand firm against things too. Not only is he saying stand firm in Christ, but he's saying stand firm as in don't do these other things which he has written about as well. When he says stand firm, he's implying stand firm against those who are compromising doctrinally. Those who are compromising the gospel, he's saying stand firm against that. He's also saying, in light of verses 17 and 18, stand firm against those with ethical compromise, those who have made gods out of their bellies and appetites. He's saying stand firm. Don't waver. Stand where you are. And so when we see the word therefore, we're looking back to understand what kind of standing this is. But we also see that he writes, therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, stand firm thus in the Lord. Another way we could translate that would be to say, stand firm in this way. Or this is what it means to stand firm in the Lord. And so all the way through chapter 4, verse 2 through verse 9, we see what it means to stand firm. What does it mean to stand firm in the Lord? Verse 2, it means to agree in the Lord. Verse 4, it means to rejoice in the Lord. Verse 5, it means to pray to the Lord and know that he is with you. Verse 8, it means to think thoughts after the Lord and who he is. Verse 9, it's to know that the Lord is the God of peace who is with you. This is what it means to stand firm in the Lord. It's all of these things put together. And so today's message is really the first of a mini-series on what does it mean to stand firm. And so today we'll look at verses 1 through 3, standing firm together. In the next message, we'll look at standing firm in prayer. And then the final one, we'll look at standing firm in thought and in deed. So, standing firm together, agreeing in the Lord. I want to explore this passage with a question. How can we stand together? How can we stand firm together? Look with me at verse 1. Paul writes, therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. How many different ways does Paul express love for the Philippian church there? Depending on how you count it, it's either 4, 5, or 6. My brothers, or brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and my crown, and then at the end, my beloved. So how can we stand firm together? First, let us develop our love. Let us develop our love. Paul piles affectionate term upon affectionate term here. And he really describes a love that is quite foreign from the types of love we see around us in our culture. In that way, this is an otherworldly love. This is a love which can only come through the gospel. The first way we see it described is it's a familial love. He says, therefore, my brothers and sisters, this is the closest of human relationships. 4 times in the book of Philippians, Paul uses this idea of brother and sister, of striving side by side, of being in this relationship. And as we explored in a previous message Sunday morning, Whenever we see this language of brother and sister, it should immediately drive our minds to the gospel reality of adoption. The fact that we have been drawn into a family. And when parents, or when our father in this case, adopt a child, siblings get another brother or sister. There's a status change that has taken place. People who were once strangers, or perhaps once even enemies, now become siblings in the gospel. And so this is a rich and deep familial love here at play. Second, it's also an affectionate love. I don't know about you, but if your family was anything like mine, there were times when you would begrudgingly confess that, yes, I love my siblings. It was a love out of duty and obligation. It was a love, perhaps, that you didn't even know where it was going at all points, but you confessed it because you knew you had to. That's not quite what's in view here. This is an affectionate love as well. It's not mere duty for siblings. It's not as though we are commanded to love, but it's also an element of really liking one another as well. One commentator writing on this verse said, if we are commanded to love, it would certainly help if we also liked our brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm not saying that you need to be friends with everyone, but listen to how Paul describes them again. I'll remind you. It's those that he loves and longs for, his beloved. This longing for really brings us back to chapter 1, verse 8, where Paul says that he yearns with the affection of Christ Jesus. Now, this is where we can get tripped up, especially in our modern use of the word affection. You see, for us, really the only kind of affectionate love, with the maybe the exception of a family, is that we say affection equals romance. Affection equals romance. And yet this is an emotional, affectionate, familial love with no hint of romance. This is an emotional love which is feeling the distance and separation. Paul says he longs to be with the Philippian church, but he's separated by distance. Perhaps you, as I can think about relationships you have with people that are separated by many, many thousands of kilometers. Maybe even hundreds of kilometers or dozens of kilometers, and you feel that distance. You feel that the love that you have for them is being impeded somehow by the distance, and Paul writes that he longs to be with them. This is not merely a love which is commanded only, but it is also a love which is real and personal and affectionate for Paul. Again, remember that wonderful passage on love, which is so often read in weddings, 1 Corinthians 13, is written in the midst of a church that is divided on so many things. That idea of love being patient and kind. That idea of love not boasting or being rude or self-centered. That's churchly love. That's love that believers ought to have for one another. Finally, it's a spiritual love as well. Paul says that he is viewing the Philippian church as his joy and his crown. In a previous message, we looked at how Paul has this image of a race in view. In verse 14, he says, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And then here, he says, my joy and my crown. Remember that in the ancient Olympic or Olympic-style games, the winner's prize would be a laurel crown. And he's saying that one of his rewards in the Christian race, one of his rewards in his life, is the faith of the Philippian church. That's the kind of love that he has for them, is that when he sees their faith and their life, he is encouraged. And he says, that is a reward from God to me. Perhaps you have a relationship like that with someone. Maybe it's someone that you led to the Lord or someone that you've discipled, someone that is in your life, and you look at that person's faith and you say, what joy that brings me. That's a rich blessing. Or perhaps you are that person for someone else, be a parent or a grandparent, looks at your life of faithfulness now and they say, Lord, what a gift to see that. What a gift to know that you have used me, imperfect me, sinful me, in that person's life. That's a great, rich blessing for Paul here. This is a personal, emotional, spiritual love in view. In light of COVID and all of the different lockdowns that people experienced, it really exacerbated an already present problem that we were in a friendship epidemic, really a lack of friendship epidemic. Do you know who the most at-risk group is for that? It's men. Men are the most at risk of not having true and lasting friendships. 15% of men say they have no friends. 15%. 50% of men say they do not have friendships they wish they had. And this is not just a problem for men, it's a problem for everyone, but can you think of a more counterintuitive and countercultural way for us as Christians to live? You say you want to be different as a Christian man? Have real, meaningful, deep friendships. Who would have thought that that would be countercultural? Who would have thought that that would be a way to stand firm in the Lord? Who would have thought that that would be the way, not to be a culture warrior, but to be a good friend? That's what this world needs. And it shouldn't surprise us, really, because Jesus said in John chapter 13 that one of the ways the world would know that he was at work was by our love for one another. In John 13, 34, he says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another." Verse 35, "By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." So brothers and sisters here tonight, have this kind of familial, affectionate, spiritual love for one another, for the sake of those around you and for the sake of the gospel. Have a deep, meaningful friendship for the sake of the gospel that others might look on and say, "I've never had a friend like that. I've never had a friend like that." These friendships require work. It requires us to be personal with people, to share emotional details, to share spiritual growth and trials, to pray with one another. So don't rush these. Don't think that this is going to happen overnight. Remember, Paul was with the church at Philippi for some time. But pursue them. Pursue these relationships. So how can we stand firm together? First, develop your love. And second, discover your likeness. Now, when we are with a friend, often that discovery of things we have in common happens very quickly. Perhaps we read the same books or watch the same movies or listen to the same music. But oftentimes when we are with Christians, we can so easily forget just how significant the things that we share in common are. I think it's because sometimes it's so easy to meet someone who shares very little in common except for this one small thing, and we latch onto that and we go incredibly deep on that one small thing instead of recognizing the incredible breadth that we have in common as Christians. Just think to yourself, if you are someone who believes that God became man and yet remained God, that he lived a perfect life, that he died on the cross and 3 days later he rose again, and that all who trust in his name can have complete, full forgiveness of their sins. Think of how much that shrinks your circle as far as people who believe all those same things. That is a powerful thing to all share in common. Much more significant than what political party you might vote for, what educational philosophy you might believe in, or even what you might do in your spare time. You see, Christians share in common the answers to all of life's biggest questions. Questions such as, who am I? What is my purpose here in life? And where am I headed? If you are a Christian here today, those three great questions, your identity, your purpose, and your destiny, you share that in common with every other Christian in this room. And so discover your likeness that you already have built in. When we read in Romans 8, one of the blessings of adoption, when we cry out, "Abba, Father," this discovering your likeness is the realization that we can also cry out, "Brother" or "Sister." That a person that we might have some familiarity with is really someone who shares that same identity, who has a shared purpose in life. There's a shared destiny one day to come. Paul writes to these people who are here, and he says that these women, Euodia and Syntyche, have labored side by side in the gospel with Clement and other fellow workers. Their names are in the book of life. You see, Euodia and Syntyche were not some fringe members of the church at Philippi. They weren't people who were just barely in the church directory, so to speak. They were co-laborers with Paul, gospel workers with Paul. He says that their names, this whole group, all of these names were written in the book of life. These are real Christians. They have this shared identity, purpose, and destiny. So often, if Christians, if we disagree on politics, for example, we must remember that we are both citizens of heaven. When we disagree on how best to educate our children, we must remember that each of us is seeking to raise them in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Even when we disagree on certain things, maybe stylistic things in worship, we must remember and believe the best about each other, that we are seeking to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Believe the best about your brothers and sisters in Christ. Do not ascribe to them wrong motives where they might not be there. Discover your likeness. Remember the identity that you share, the purpose for which you are both here, and the destiny that you have in heaven. So how can we stand firm together? How can we agree in the Lord? We must develop our love, and we must discover our likeness. And third and finally, we must die to self. We must die to self. Based on the way that Paul treats this disagreement, it really does seem like this is a personal disagreement. It was an individual issue. But it was an individual issue which was beginning to split the church. Without a doubt, there would have been a development of Euodian camp and the Syntychian camp. We know what that's like, don't we? That a church division, like a cancerous cell, doesn't just stay put, but it spreads. It creates factions and divisions and separates in such a way that pretty soon the church is divided. Like today, this division was neither doctrinal nor ethical, but a division of some kind of self-interest. And so Paul gives his encouragement. He says, agree in the Lord. I think that's significant. And it's significant with this idea of dying to self, is he's saying to them, even if you don't actually agree on that one specific thing, you need to agree on the Lord and in the Lord. You need to recognize that what you share in common is so much more important than what you disagree on. And it's important to stress this again and again, that this type of agreement, this type of unity, is only actually possible where people are in the Lord. Paul is not saying to a Christian and a Muslim to agree to disagree and move on. Paul is not writing to the dogs, the mutilators, the evildoers, and saying to the Philippian church, they might have a bit of a different view about justification, but agree to disagree and move on. He's saying to Euodia and Syntyche, these really wonderful women who have labored side by side in the gospel, to put aside their differences, to lay down their self-interest, to die to self and to agree in the Lord, to remember where their agreement really does lie. To remember, like he said in chapter 2, verse 2 and 5, that they have the mind of Christ, that they are one in mind. No time is spent on who wins. Paul doesn't say Euodia, Syntyche is totally right. He says agree in the Lord. Whatever right or wrong answer might be here, that's not really consequential. Have you ever had one of those arguments where you look at the person across from you and you say, I'm really mad at you? I have no reason why. That might have been what's going on here, is that things had gone so far and so far past healing that they now have no reason to get back together and they have no reason to apologize because they can't even remember what it was about. But in times like that, what does Paul say? Agree in the Lord. And Paul also gets really practical. He appoints and says to them where they are to turn for help. He says, I ask you, my true companion, help these women, implied, to agree in the Lord. And we don't know who that true companion was. It might have been someone's name, or it might have been Epaphroditus, who's taking this letter back to the Philippian church. But regardless of that, it's a reminder to us that we must be willing to both be helped and to help those in this kind of disagreement. Think of the dying to self that it takes to ask someone for help if you need it to agree in the Lord. To recognize that you need some mediation to help you pursue peace. It's a great sacrifice of pride to admit that you need help. I think in Matthew 18, in that famous passage that we so often think of when we come to church discipline, and rightly so, the idea of bringing a person with you is not merely to witness the sin, but hopefully to pursue peace. The goal there is not just to bring someone alongside you so that they can witness it, but hopefully, perhaps, to win back your brother or sister there. To die to self. That is, of lay aside your self-interest in order that you might win your brother or your sister. And at this point, we must really ask ourselves, should it surprise us that when it comes to the church, final encouragement, the final exhortation would be to die to self in order to bring about peace? Because really, is that not just the message of the gospel? That Jesus didn't just die to self, but he died, full stop. He died in order to bring about peace between warring people and a holy God. He died to bring about peace and reconciliation where there was none. He died to bring about peace between sinners and a thrice holy God. Jesus Christ, turning back to Philippians 2, did not look out for his own interests. Jesus Christ did not grasp or hang on to equality with God as something to use for his own advantage. He was not self-serving like these women here or like we were in our lives. But he humbled himself, became the form of a servant, was found in human likeness, and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And so when we exhort one another to die to self, to lay aside our needs, we are not doing something that is possible in and of our own strength. We are not doing something that is possible in and of our own selfish nature. We are doing something which mirrors the great selfless love of our Savior. The great selfless love which first brought about peace with us and with God. Peace with us and our fellow brothers and sisters. For it's incredible to look at the Philippian church and to think that this difference here, this Euodian and Syntychian difference, was brought about in a church that was really miraculously put together. You see, this church, remember, if you go back all the way to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 16, was made up of people like that Greek slave girl, was made up of people like Lydia, that Middle Eastern businesswoman. It was made up of people like the Roman centurion. It was made up of people like the Apostle Paul, a Jewish rabbi. And so these people with nothing in common are brought together miraculously in the gospel and are brought together miraculously with peace across one another because of the peace that they have with God. The peace that we have with God ought to bring about peace with one another. There's an illustration told of a Scottish pastor who went on a pastoral visit to a church member who had been long absent from worship services. And I hope I'm not offending any people of Scottish heritage, but the stereotype goes that Scottish people aren't those who tend to talk about their feelings very much with one another. And so in this pastoral visit, the pastor sat down in the chair beside the roaring fire with his congregant, and they just stood and sort of sat and looked at the fire for some time. Eventually, the pastor took the fire tongs and took out of the fire an ember and sat it down on the hearth. And they continued to sit side by side. Eventually, as you would expect, the ember grew darker and darker, and eventually it was black and cold. At that point, he took the tongs again, put the ember into the fire, and all of a sudden it was glowing. It was orange and it was warm. And the congregant looked at his pastor and said, "Pastor, thank you for that fiery sermon. I'll be back in church next week." You see, that's really what this idea of unity and this idea of Christians agreeing in the Lord is all about, is that when we cut ourselves off from that rich fellowship, when we cut ourselves off from the ordained love that God has meant for us to have, when we have that kind of separation like an ember from a fire, we grow cold We stop experiencing the heat and the love and the warmth that God intended for us because He intended it to take place in and through His people at church. So what does it mean to stand firm in the Lord? The first thing it means is to stand firm together. Will you pray with me? Father in heaven, we thank You that You have not left us alone, that You have not left us as individuals, as renegades, as lone rangers, but instead You have brought us into a family, a community, a church. Lord, we pray that we would stand firm together, and in standing firm, we would support and strengthen one another and uplift those who are weary, strengthen those who are weak, and encourage those around us, we pray. Lord, cause us to agree together in You, not agreeing on everything, but agreeing on the most important things and laying aside our differences, we ask. It's in our Savior's name we pray. Amen. All right. In just a moment, we'll stand and sing our final song together. How firm a foundation. The church is one foundation. We'll be singing a song about foundations. God's final word of blessing to us this evening from 2 Corinthians,
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.